Hello, this is Jack Jackson, and we're going to be looking today at Excel and using Excel to do some descriptive statistics and see some of the tools that are built in to Excel and how to make use of them. So I'm starting with an Excel spreadsheet here, and this particular spreadsheet already has some data in it. This is some information about the presidents of the United States of America. So here we have them listed in order. All the way back from the very first one, George Washington there, all the way down to the current president as I am giving this talk, which is Barack Obama. So you can see it's 2012 when I'm making this video. So we have information on the order, the name of the person, and the party. In the next column, the year they took office, the year they left office, how many years in office there were, what state they were born in, their birth date, death date, religion, inauguration day, age, and death age at their inauguration. And in the case of when they serve consecutive terms, of course, this is their first one, inauguration. We do have one kind of unusual place down here where Grover Cleveland actually gets two lines because Benjamin Harrison served a term in between Cleveland's two terms. So unlike the other presidents, he gets a two lines, even though, many of the other presidents served two terms. He's the only one that had someone serve a term in between. We also, well, we have this data. So suppose we want to analyze some of this. So for example, we're just going to look at how old they were when they were inaugurated. So first thing I'm going to do is click on this with my mouse, drag it down here, and copy this information. Now I can go up here and select copy, but the easiest thing to do really is just to do Control C if you're in Windows. And I'm going to go to this next sheet over here, and I'll start right here and do Control V, which is paste. And so this is going to paste in those ages. Now I'm really only interested in their inauguration, the very first inauguration. Some of these were inaugurated more than once, but we do have a duplicate here. And that's Cleveland. So let's see if we can find him here. He is, we want to remove this 55 right there. So 47 to 55. We want to move that second 55. There it is. So we want to get rid of that one. And then let's move the rest of this data up. So I'm just going to, I can say delete that entire row because I don't have anything else on it, or delete that cell. We'll just delete that cell, move everything up. And so now we've removed duplications. Every president is only listed once, and this is their age the first time they were inaugurated. Some were inaugurated only once, and some twice. And in the case of Franklin Delano Roosevelt, he was inaugurated four times. Okay, so suppose we want to analyze this. Well, I can do several things. One thing I can do is there are various built-in formulas that we can make use of in Excel. Notice, by the way, how I'm resizing some columns here. So we can make a little table here of some statistics. I'll put a label. Here's the formula in Excel, and then the value. And I don't like the way that looks, so I'm going to take that and I'm going to make it bold, and I'm going to center it. In fact, I'm going to center it vertically as well as horizontally. So what might we be interested in? Well, one of the first things we might be interested in is our 5-point summary, our quartiles. So we would want, what we're talking about there, of course, is the minimum, the first quartile, Q1, the median, the third quartile or upper quartile, Q3, and then the maximum. Okay, so what would we put in here? Well, to find the minimum, if you're not sure how to do a formula, see this little f sub x button here for insert a function. Just click on that. Now we can type in something here that we want to do and it'll search for us. We can go to some that we've recently used. We can also go to click on this little arrow right here and we can list them all. This will just list them all in alphabetical order. Or since we know this is a statistical formula, we can go down here to statistics and that will limit us a little bit. And what we want is minimum, and it's probably going to be this one right here, min. So it says min of, give a list of numbers, returns the smallest number in a set of values. It ignores logical values in text. So if you have any cells with text in them, or empty cells, it will just completely ignore them. Logical values are values that return true or false. So just it'll just basically look at the numbers. So that's what we want. We want that. And we can, by going through this function wizard, the f sub x thing, it kind of tells us some stuff that we can put here. So what we can do here is click arrange. So we can just go over here and click on this and highlight the range that we want. Click OK, and that returns it. I'm going to center that. Now, if we knew that was minimum, we could just type in. Always start your formulas with an equals min of, highlight the data, close parentheses. Now, notice up here is our formula, the minimum from A3 to A45. Now, if we know it's A3 to A45, we don't have to highlight it. We can just type that in. And of course, that's going to give us the same thing. Now, I'm going to just so that I'll have a record of it, I'm going to copy this. And I'm going to do, whoops. Okay, go here. Here's the formula. I'm going to go here and copy. Control C, hit enter. And I'm going to go here. Now I want the actual text of what we did. So if I type that same thing in here, if I just do Control V and paste this, again I'm going to get 42. This time I want it to actually show the formula. So I'm going to actually go in here to the front and put an apostrophe before that. Anytime you put an apostrophe in the front of something, it definitely tells it you have to treat what's after that as text. And so now that shows us the formula there for that particular statistic. And here is its value over here. Okay. In a similar way, we can do maximum. And so the maximum, I'll put the apostrophe to start with. Formula we're going to type in is equal max of, and it's the same range, so I can go A3 colon A45, enter. And of course, I want that, copy and paste it here without the apostrophe, we'll actually figure the value of that maximum. So, just looking at this, we see that our presidents at inauguration, that the youngest one was 42 and the oldest one was 69. Now, notice what we've lost here, of course, is that A is the actual people. Do you know who these were? Okay, let's take a look back here and see if we can find them. Actually, the oldest one out here at 69 was Ronald Reagan. And the youngest one at 42 was actually right here, 42, Theodore Roosevelt. Okay. All right. I can do a similar thing for a median. Now, notice if I do, let me show you something if I do something here. If I take this, copy, and paste it here. Something happened to the formula. Look here. A3 to A45. When I copied and pasted down here, still minimum, but it's A5 to A47. Notice what it did is it changed these numbers. But if I go here and put a dollar sign in front of this, well, let's say if I just do that. Now if I copy and paste it down here, notice the 3 didn't change, but the 47 changed from a 45. If I make them both dollar signs, now they both got change here. In this case, it didn't affect the value. But now if I just change that minimum to a median, I get the median of the data set. And so now we have the formula for the median as well. Now, quartiles, well, if you're not sure how to do it, we can do fx. Let's see. Good chance it's under quartile. Yep, sure enough, there it is. Quartile. Now, quart is which quartile? 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4 would be which quartile? So we could have actually gotten the minimum as the 0th quartile, of course. So quartile 1, we put a 1 here, and the array is our data, wherever our data is. There it is. Now, of course, look at the way the formula worked. Actually, I want to... So it's actually quartile A3 to A45 1. So let me go ahead and write that here. Equal quartile A3 to A45. And let's go ahead and do what we call absolute referencing the 3 and the 45, so they won't change if I copy this. Now, one more thing, though, you tell it which quartile you want. We want the first quartile. So now if I take that and copy it and paste it here, but change it from quartile 1 to quartile 3, we get the other quartile, just like that. So we'll go ahead and copy that formula over here. Of course, normally you don't actually show everybody what your formula is. So let's do this again. Copy, Control C, Enter, come over here, apostrophe, paste. So there's your quartile there. And actually, I'm just going to copy this and paste it and change the 1 to a 3. Now, let me also remind you that the method that the Excel uses to find the first quartile and the third quartile are slightly different than the method used by the TI calculators to find the same values. So you get a little bit different value if you typed all these in your calculator, possibly. Depends on the data set. Sometimes they're the same, but often they're a little bit different. So anyway, those are our quartiles. All right. Next, let's do some measures of central tendency. Mean, median, and mode, and mid-range. Okay, well, the mid-range is going to be the easiest to find because we've already figured out the maximum and the minimum. So it can just be this one minus this one. Or we could actually type it in this way, equals the maximum. That's the range. It is the average of those two. So it is the minimum plus the maximum in parentheses divided by 2. There we go. And we could do it this way. We could do parentheses max of, let's see, it would actually be uppercase. You could type it either way, but A3 to A45 plus min A3 to A45, parentheses around that, divide by 2. So we're averaging those two things. That would also get it to the mid-range. Median, if it's spelled correctly. Median, well, we've already seen how to do that. Here we go. It's this. And I do have the dollar signs there, so this will copy correctly. Mean is just called average in this. So it's equals average. And again, it's A3 to A45. See. Well, okay, do it again. Now, when you have this, the number of digits will expand as we expand the window here up to a certain point. But we can also click on this thing here to add some digits or subtract some digits. So suppose we just want, say, that many digits. Now, I don't believe there is a mode function. Let's see, there might be. Let's take a look here. Statistical, let's find mode. Oh, there is, good. Mode, very well, mode. Of again, A3 down to A45. Usually it's just easiest to get it that way. Oh, very nice. So that was just mode A3 to A45. And so, whoops. So there is the mode. So we've seen the mean, the median, the mode, and the mid-range. So these right here, let's make some lines for them here. We'll do the same thing here. Actually, we're just going to get several things here. So we have some measures of central tendency. Well, we could even do... We could even do a couple of fancier things here. Watch this. We can take these cells here, and we can group them together. Let's see here. I've got a shortcut up here, but let's see how we do it. To remember how we do this here. That'll do it. If I just click on that one, that'll merge and center. That'll do it. And I can type in here quartiles. And I can have I'll just say center. Measures of center. And I can even take these and rotate the text, say going this way. So now we see that we have measures of, we have quartiles, measures of center, and measures of well, measures of center and quartiles so far. Quartiles are measures of relative position. Now, suppose we want some measures of variability. Well, the easiest one is range. And then there's also standard deviation. And variance. Okay, let's scoot this over a little bit so we can line that up a little bit better. Okay, so let's see if there's a range command in there already. It would probably just be range if there is. Okay, there's not a range one here, and that's not surprising because Excel uses the word range for something else. It would call this group this A3 to A45, it would call that a range. Of course, that's not what we mean in statistics. Of course, we have other meanings. A range is the output, set of all outputs for a function. We sometimes use that in our math classes. But range and as a statistic, of course, it would equal the maximum, again, of A3 to A45 minus the minimum of A3 to A45. Okay, or since I already have them up here, it's even easier. I just say equals this one, click on that, minus that one. So that's the range. There is a standard deviation function. Actually, there are two, as you might suspect. There is STDEV is the standard deviation. It's the normal one. That's the sample standard deviation. We use the letter S for that. We do have two others. The STDEVP is for a population, if it is the entire population. And this one with A does some things with logical values. It treats them actually as numbers. So what we want is STDEV, because we're going to think of this as a sample. So it would be STDEV of, again, it's A3 to A45. That's, and of course we would have to start it with an equals. I got the apostrophe there, so this is text. But if I copy that, paste it there, yeah, that's the correct formula. And again, I can add some decimal places or take some away. Standard deviation. Let's see if it's got one for variance. If it doesn't, we can fix it pretty easily. Yeah, there's the variance, VAR. Is the variance, and then we have these other versions here. So we can say equals VAR of, again, A3 to A45. Of course, we could have also just said take this number here and square it. Power 2, we get, of course, the same thing. Or, of course, we could have gone, say, equals this number, and say to the power 0.5, that would be a square root. Or, I think you can do SQRT, I think. Yeah, SQRT of this. That will give it to you the same way. So, really, you can find the standard deviation and square it to get the variance, or the variance and square root to get the standard deviation. But there are built-in functions for each. So this gives you some basic things that we can do. Let me see if there's a mean absolute deviation. I've got a feeling that probably will not show up in this one. It does not. So if we were going to do that, we would have to actually go through and sort of do it by hand, so to speak, or not really completely by hand, but we'd have to be real go through all the steps. So these are measures of variability. Again, let's turn that around like the others. And we can can't see that all. A couple options. Let me just make the text smaller. Let's do it like that. And so now we have some measures of variability as well. Okay, so there are some basic numerical descriptive statistics. Now, let's look at some measures, some counts, and some visual statistics, some graphs. So notice that we start at 42, and then we go up to 69. So what I want to do here is I'm going to make a list of all the ages. Again, it's the same heading as this, so I'm just going to copy and paste that. Still inauguration age, but I'm going to start at 42. And we're going to center that. And I'm going to say, there's actually a couple ways to do this, but I'm going to put a formula equals 1 plus the one above. Now this time when I copy it, I do want it to always be 1 plus the 1 above. So if you notice, if I copy this and paste it, it is this what was H3 here becomes H4 here, and that's what I want this time. So this time if I copy that and paste it down here, let's go all the way down, let's see how far. I want to go down to 69. Okay, I went a little too far. We can get rid of these extras. Now, I want to take this, let's see here, let's do a couple of things. Let's find a frequency here. Now suppose what if you like the way a certain thing looks, like we like the way that looks, it's bold, it's centered vertically and horizontally, I can click on this format painter and click on this cell and it'll give it the same thing, the same font, the same size of the font, and so forth. Now I want it to count all the 42s. I don't want to have to go through there and count them all. So there's a formula for that too. It's count if. So equals count if parentheses. Again, the same range, and I'm just going to get it by highlighting it. Like that, comma, and I'm just going to click on this cell to the left. And what this will do is it will go through in each one of these from A3 to A2, A3, A4, A5, all the way up to A45. It will see if it's the same as 42, as whatever's in the cell H3. If it is, it'll add 1 to the count starting at 0. And it counts them all up, and sure enough, we only have 1 right there. Now, if I'll make sure that this 3 will always stay a 3, and this 45 a 45, and I could even do the A's, make sure that they're always A's, then I know I'm dealing with that same data range. Now, it doesn't change that formula at all, but now when I copy it and paste it, it is looking to the cell to the left each time. And so now we have our counts. Some of them are 0 because I listed every single one. Now, Excel does not do a dot plot, but it does do a bar graph or a histogram. And so if you have every single data value listed out there with no skips, we can do a histogram of this data right here. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to highlight all of these datas, including the zeros, like this. And we're going to make a histogram of this data. This is an ungrouped frequency histogram, which is really essentially the same thing as a dot plot. So we're going to go to Insert, and it's some kind of column graph. And we just want this basic one. Generally speaking, 3D graphs may look pretty, but they're really not as easy to read, and they often can distort the data. So we really better stay with the 2D graph. And so we're going to look at this one here. And there we go, there's our data. Now a couple things we don't need. We don't need the name of the series, so we're going to get rid of that. Okay, there are some things that we do need. Okay, first of all, this is a histogram, and these bars really that are next to each other really should be touching. So I'm going to fix that. I'm going to click on one of the bars, right click on it, and I'm going to say format the data series. So I'm going to go to no gap, and that puts them together. Now these particular bars, same color and everything, it's hard to see where they separate, so I'm going to put a border color of a solid line, and I'm just going to go with a black line so we can see that. You can make the bars more and more transparent so you can see through them, but I don't want it to be any transparency to them, so we'll just leave it like that. We can go to fill and change the color of the fill, or even put a pattern on there or a texture. Well, let's play around with that. So, for example, if we go to solid fill and we don't like that color, say we want purple, for example, there we go. Or I could even go to a picture or a texture fill and pick some kind of texture here. You know, if I wanted to, I could fill it with some kind of American flag pattern or something, if I could find something on the internet. But let's just go with something fairly simple, just a solid fill like that. So now we got some nice little purple bars. Notice there are some missing here. Now, if you notice though, the data at the bottom is wrong. It just says 1 through 28, and of course those were obviously not the ages of the presidents. We want the ages down there. So we're going to get that we'll right click on here, and we'll go to select data. Now this data here, the cell chart data range, that's the range that we selected. You can see it highlighted over here. That's the data values. But we want to know if the axis labels are right here. So I'm going to click on edit, and I want to go over here and highlight those and say OK and click OK again. And now we have the data values. Now I'm going to move this down here and then come down and look at it. And I'm going to actually stretch it out this way a little bit. Okay. I think I could see my numbers at the bottom a little bit better that way. Okay, so that's not bad. If I wanted to, I could go down here and change those to bold, for example. I might decide to make them a little bit smaller, like a 9 there. And so anyway, there we have a frequency histogram, or it'd be the same thing as a dot plot. We would have one dot here, one dot here, two dots here, one here, two here, one, two, three, four here, and so forth. So this is more or less the same thing as a dot plot. But notice you couldn't do it from the original data. You had to make sure you had a list going from the smallest to the largest, going up by ones. So that was, or just going up by something so that we don't miss any data values. You know, we don't want, there should be a gap here in our bar graph. Or the same thing if you did a dot plot. Now, there are some other things missing from this. This, we need to label everything. So if we just go to layout here, we have some options here. So the chart title. I usually like above the chart, so I'm going to click on that, and we put some sort of title. It's very important you get a title on your charts, either in the like this in the chart itself, or just type it in the text if you're going to put this in a document. So this is ages of U.S. presidents at first inauguration. And again, I can click on something here, and I can go over here and change the, you know, what color that is, if I want that to be purple as well, or if I don't like that particular font and want to go to some other, you know, some other font here. I've got different, you know, lots of different options. Let's say if I go to something like, well, let's see. Let's see if it gives us a color. Let's just go to Cambria, for example. Okay. Now, a couple other things that we can do with this, just to show you some things you can do with tables like this and charts. I can go and add some. Let's go back to click on the chart itself and go to layout. I can go to titles, the primary horizontal axis. I can put a title down here and put age. And if I want to, I can put one on the other one, although it's kind of implied here, but I can, what would be appropriate here. Let's say we can go a couple of different ways we could do it. I like a title like this. And we can say this is frequency, because that's what it actually is. So there's a frequency histogram of the ages of U.S. presidents at the first inauguration. Now, this is a completely ungrouped frequency histogram, essentially the same as a dot plot. So this actually has all of the actual original data on this graph. One more thing we can do to make it look a little, maybe a little prettier. We go to format the chart area, and we can put a fill in there. Let's maybe just put a picture or texture fill here. And what would look good? We've got purple text, so let's not go too crazy here. But let's give it a little a white marble. Let's see what that looks like. Yeah, not too bad. Okay, and so we get that. You can also... in addition, you can give this part the plot area. We can give it some kind of a fill. Let's just give it a real light color there. And so now we have our graph, and it's completed. Okay, and so all those little elements you can control a little bit. Another thing that you can do, if you want, is you can take it and put data labels, say, outside the ends here, which will give the actual counts. In this particular case, that's makes it too busy, and it's not really needed. So we're going to turn those off. But sometimes that's useful to have. Now, what if we want to do a stem and leaf plot? I don't think this has any kind of built-in stem and leaf plot. But once we do have the data in order, we can sort of generate our own stem and leaf plot, or we could do it a little bit at a time. But notice we have 40s, 50s, and 60s, so we could do it with one line. So this is a stem and leaves, and this is one line per stem. Okay, so in the 40s we see we have 142, so that's a 2, 43, a 3, 2 46s, 47, two of them, 48, 249s. And I want to make sure that that's text, and if I put a, that'll make it over to the left, so that's good. And then we can do the 50s. Start with the apostrophe. 250s, that's 00. 451s, 1, 2, 3, 4 ones. 252s, 1, 2. 554s, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 55s, 3 fives, 3 sixes here for 56, 4 sevens, 58, and that's all of those. And in the 60s, we have a 60, 3 61s, a 62. 264s, 65, 68 and a 69. And so now this is a stem and leaf plot. For our data. Now that's one line per stem, but well, one thing that sort of jumps out at you automatically there is, well, definitely way more in the 50s than in either the 40s or the 60s. None below 42, none above 69. Okay, but sometimes we like to split this up, maybe two lines per stem. So we could have two 40s, two lines for the 40s, two for the 50s, two for the 60s. So that means the first one is going to be, let me just do it this way, copy and paste it here and here. But the first one is only going to be two, three, and fours. Zero, two, three, four. And 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, the first 5, and the others will be the second 5, 5, 6, 7, 8, or 9. And so we just get rid of these like that. Now we split the stem of the 40s stem up into two parts. Likewise, we're going to split the 50s up like this. So this one only go up to 4, and this one will start at 5 and go on up. And then we'll do the same thing with the 60s. Okay, and so that's two lines per stem. We could try to do three lines per stem, but the problem with three or four lines per stem is we have 10 possible digits. And really to do four, say three lines per stem, we would have to split these things at a third, in between. We'd have to split them at some fraction. And that's not really, really good for us here because, of course, we want these to be evenly spaced out. So it's best in this case if we're going to do a multiple of, a factor of 5. So either 1, 2, or 5 lines per stem is better. Okay, so 5 of these, actually 4 doesn't have a 0 or 1, so we'll only end up with 4 4s, 1, 2, 3, 4 4s, 5 5s, and 5 6, 5 6s. So the 2, 3, 0, 1, we don't have any, 2, 3, goes here. 4, 5. We don't have any of those, so that would go there. 6, 7 would go here. So no 8 or 9, just 6, 7. And then the 8, 9s would go here. Alright, the 5s. The 0, 1s would go there. The 2, 3s would go next. Don't have any 3s, but we've got some 2s. And then the 4, 5s would go here. Okay, let's see. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 4s and 3, 5s. The 6, 7s next, so we'll get rid of the 5s and the 8, and then the 8, 9s here. We just have the 1, 8. The 60s will be broken up to the 60 and 61. And then Sixty-two, three, and 4 and 5. And then the 8 and 9. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and then 8, 9. So this one should be down here, and there is nothing on that one. Okay, so a couple of these are missing spots. But there we have 5 lines per stem. And of course, if you did 10 lines per stem, then you're really just back to doing the same thing that you would have. Basically, you have exactly the same as a dot plot, more or less. Now, which of these is the best one to do? Well, this one is probably too few stems, or too few lines, to give you a good picture of what's going on. This is probably more than is needed here. It starts to get too many. And this one is sort of like Goldilocks. This one is just right. Something along the lines of you want the total lines. There's no hard and fast rule, but, you know, this is 6 lines. That's pretty good. 6 lines, 7, 8, 9, 10 lines. You don't really want more than that, usually. So that's kind of a good one there. But it can be done any of those ways. Now, that one we really ended up doing by hand because Excel wouldn't do that one. But Excel did will put the data in order for us, or it will do counts that we had over here. So the counts were nice. We can also put the data in order. Okay, so let me take this same data, copy it, and paste it here. In fact, I want to insert a. Well, the easier way to do that over the normal way is to go over here and say insert a column. So I just wanted to insert a little bit of a empty column there, and this is ordered. Age. Actually, the first column is ordered too, but not by the ages. It's ordered by the what order they served in office. Okay, so I can go and highlight some data here. And if you want to do a simple sort, you can go smallest to largest or largest to smallest. Okay, notice that I had data here and it's asking me if I want to include that. No, I want to continue with the current one. And so notice it's put it in order for us. So now you can see there's the 42, there's the 43, there's your 246s. And so forth. You could also go through here and add more complicated if you've got something here. I'm not going to follow through with this, but if I go through here to a custom sort, I can sort it by some column. I can add levels to it if there are multiple things. Okay, let's continue on here. So in some sense, just like we group these things together, we might want to group the data together in our, instead of just having a frequency table like this, we might also want to have a grouped frequency. And let's use the same grouping here. And so this is the ages, and so here is 42 to 43, then 44 to 45, no, that's like the one down here. I want to use the one up here. I want to do 40 to 44, 45 to 49. 50 to 54, 55 to 59, 60 to 64, and 65 to 69. And I can give their frequency. And I can just count from the stem and leaf plot here pretty easily. So there are 2, and there. 7 in here. Next one has 13, if I counted those right. And this is, I think, let's see. And then 7 and 3. And let's get a total for that. Now, to add up stuff is really easy. You just click on this sum button and it highlights the ones you want to add up. Hit enter. It tells us there's 46. Let's see if that's right here. We should be able to do that by. Okay, one way we can do it is summing these up. And summing up these frequencies. Uh-oh, 43. Make sure I got this one right. Okay, I've made a mistake somewhere. Let's see if I can find it. Let me count these. Okay, so these add up the same as that. So I've got three extra ones somewhere. Let's see if I can find my mistake. So I can also do something like this. I can sum just these here. Just two. And then go down here to this one. And sum these five. Now, that's going to do nicely if I just go down here and say like this, this, and just copy and paste these. So 3, 7, 11, okay, right here. I've got too many 57s. There should be just four of those. I thought that might be the problem. One, two, three, four, just four 57s. Is that a problem up here too? There we go. And I bet that's a problem here too. Ah, there we go. Now that's fixed. That's a little better. Now, so that means that this one is down to 11. All right, that totals up, I believe, the same. Yes, same as what we had here. Alright, so this data here, let's center that, give us some little little bit of a border there. And let's make a graph of this. So this is going to be a grouped frequency histogram. Okay, so I'm going to select that data there. And again, I do it like I did before, go to a column graph, click over here, and we're going to make the same thing, same adjustments we did before. So this series, we don't need that, so I'm just going to delete that. We're going to right click on the data, format that data series. We don't need any gap here. If we're going to do that, we probably want to give us a nice solid line around our color. We can leave this one like it is, I guess, for color, and then we can go here. We might want to go this time. There are fewer bars. We might want to actually add the data labels to it. So those are that gives the counts there. Although you can certainly read them from the side over here. All right, let's move that down here, and let's fix the fix some things here. Let's go with formatting the chart area. Oh, what do we want to fill with this time? Just whatever we have a feeling for. Okay, we'll give this a nice little crinkled paper background, let's say. white's a little boring. Let's give it a little bit of a color to it. Not too much of anything, just something really light. Okay, and that little crinkled paper is kind of hard to see. I don't like that too well. Let's try something else. Let's try something lighter. Okay, and we can go to layout, give us a chart title, and really it's the same chart titles we had before. Pages of U.S. presidents. At first inauguration. I don't like the way they went to two lines. Let's make the font just a little smaller. So that's 18. 14 is gonna be fine. Now, once I'm in here, I can actually click on this and make this a little bigger. I can make the whole thing a little bit, stretch it out, and kind of make the dimensions of it whatever I want. Now, our date at the bottom is not too good. We want to go our labels, so we want to just right-click out here in the thing and go to select data, edit the horizontal category, and now we're going to select here, which is our ranges, and let's see if those fit and look okay. Yeah, that looks pretty good. Maybe we should make them bold. And now there we go. We have us a nice little grouped frequency histogram of the ages of the U.S. presidents at their first inauguration. These ranges right here are sometimes called bins, B-I-N-S, bins. Okay, so there's a couple of things that we can do for counts. Okay, I can name the sheet, name the tab, which sheet. I can click here, and this is an analysis of ages at first. Kind of a long tab name, but if I don't have too many tabs, that's okay to have something like that. So now we have some data analysis that we've done here, computing some statistics and drawing some graphs. Now I can take any of this information, like say this here, copy this, and if I have my Microsoft Word document, for example, or a PowerPoint slide, I can go over here, add whatever kind of text I want, and then paste that in there. So, depending on the where you might want to publish this in a book or a journal or a newspaper, they're all going to have different formatting requirements. Require that instead of a label here or in addition to that, you have a certain type of thing up here and you label them figure one, figure two. I'll leave that to your style sheets for your classes that you might want to write a report for, research paper. But now we're just seeing how we can get some basic graphs generated. But notice how it's pretty easy to put them into Word. They can also be resized in Word if it's too big or too little, and you can experiment with this stuff. In fact, Word, you can do a lot of the same formatting things that you did directly in Excel. You can also do them directly in Word. Okay, back to Excel. Let's see what else we can do here with this. Let's look at some other data here instead of ages. The ages, of course, were ratio type data. Okay, that's the level. Let's look at some attribute data, that is nominal data. Suppose we wanted to look at their party. Okay, so let's. Okay, here's some more data in a different format. Okay, some of this is a little more detailed. You get to an empty sheet here. Move this over, and let's look at their party. Okay, so maybe we could go over here and just pull out the party. And in fact, let's do this. Let's pull out the party and the years in office. So we'll see how many years a certain party was in office. So I'm going to actually copy all of this and pull this over. And I'm going to take out this part here in the middle. Years in office. Years in office was actually done by formula. See how that's done there? So what I want to do is I want to take that data and we're going to go over here and put it here. But if I put paste, it's going to try to subtract some stuff that's not even there. It's going to, in fact, even refers to some cells that aren't even there. But I can go to paste, and there's some special things I can do. Just the formula, just the values. Transpose, so it turns it sideways. Some different things. But I'm just going to go to paste values. And so now these are coming over as just numbers, but not as formulas. So again, these are also in the order that they served. So let's see what kind of... If we don't really care what order they served, I can go here and highlight this data. And let's say we can sort it by the first column there. So we can sort, we can do a custom sort, and we want to sort by the party in alphabetical order. And we can see what we have there. So we're going to put 4 for Obama for the moment. He may get another term, but we will see. Okay, and we have these in order, and so let's pull these across here and separate them out. Democrat, Democratic Republican, Federalist, Republican, and I'm going to put Republican and Democrat at the top because they're going to be the most common. And I believe there we have Unionist and Whig as well. So let's do those and bring those up. So these are all the parties. And let's go ahead and, since I have them kind of grouped together, it won't be hard to figure these out. So for Democrat, we can sum up the years in office this way because we're just summing up all these that are connected. That's correct. Democratic, Republican. Just summing those. Federalist. Here we go. Unionist. There's only one of those. Let's type it in for. And Whig. We had a couple of those early on. There, and then the Republicans. Let's get those. So we can see which party has been in office the most. Well, pretty close, actually. Republican and Democrat. If President Obama gets another term, then we'll end up being tied there for those. Okay, so we might want to make a bar graph of this, but we might also want it to be a Pareto graph, for example. So I want to put those in order, so I'm going to it's going to be easy to do it this way. Okay, so now they're actually in decreasing order. And so let's take those and do a bar graph there. Insert column graph. Now here we don't want the bars to touch. Okay, but I do want them closer together than that. So let's take them and format the data series. I don't want to go to zero, all the way to zero gap, but I want to be kind of small here. And I do like to have a little bit of a border around them. Okay, and we need to change the labels. And that's not what I want. Select data. Do it, I believe. No, I put it in the wrong one. Cancel. Try that again. It is this one that we want. And that gives us what we need there. Let's make that a little bit. Okay, and we better put a title on there. Certainly got to have us a title. Pareto chart. Political parties. Now, what this doesn't have on a Pareto that a Pareto usually has is a cumulative ogive. But I'm gonna just leave it like that. So now we have a bar graph or frequency graph. And if you want, you can even you can click on a particular bar here, and if we want to do our format data point, and we can go to, you know, we can do the thing that they do on the now. Whoops, let's try that again. We can fill it. That. Okay, I just have the one highlighted now. So we can do a little red and blue thing, for example. Okay, and there may be some other colors for some of these others. Just pick whatever color we want. We're going to try to do different colors. Did not mean to do that. Okay. Control Z is undo in Windows. One of the nicest things ever invented. I think I'm getting ready to do it again. Make sure this one is highlighted. And then I can format that data point, change some color on the fill. And anyway, you can just experiment with this sort of thing and and make it look like whatever you want it to look like. So if you want to make them different colors, you know, that we can do that. And so now we have a Pareto chart there of the number of years in office and this is by number of years of office. Actually, we can just put that on our scale, on our axes over here. So if we go to layout, axes, title, let's do that. I don't like it like that. I like it going. This way. Okay. And again, if we want, not, again, this is optional, but you can do other things like add labels. Okay. We can also do the same information in a circle graph. Okay. Let's say we take exactly the same information and do it in a circle graph. So we could highlight this here, go to insert, pie graph or circle graph. They do these with the wedge pulled out. 3D, again, 3D graphs are not a good idea, especially on these circle graphs, because they really distort things. The way it's rotated makes a big difference. The pieces of the pie that are closer to you look bigger than they should be, and the ones further away look smaller than they should. But we can look at a basic pie graph like that. And it came out in different colors there. If I wanted to, I could go back and change these colors to match. But I'm not going to bother doing that right now. I'll just change one of them. Alright, now we have a legend here, but we do need to change a couple things. We need to go to select data, and when it says axis labels, we need to make sure they're chosen from this. So now that shows up in our legend, and so you can just do it that way only. But we may also want some other labels. Okay, I can right click and then say add data labels. So we can have the number there. And we have some options on data labels. So data labels, let's see, go to more options. Let's see what we have. We can show the value, the percentage. We can show the series name. Okay, let me show you what each one of these does. So if we just show the series name, now that's nothing for this because it's only one series. Category name, okay, now that's some useful information because it puts the, instead of having to look at the, over at the legend, we can look at it directly from here. We can show leader lines, and what that does, that's these little lines that go, here's one right here that goes from there to there. We can show the value if we want, and we can show the percentage if we want. Or we can, you know, we can turn parts of these on and parts of these off. We can have all the labels on the outside, just inside, centered up on it, or have it sort of try to pick what's best. Okay, so there we go. There's the same information in a circle graph. Now if you had to draw this one by hand, this is actually a lot more difficult to do. It's kind of interesting to me. I've done a lot of work teaching fractions, and it's interesting to see that when you ask students to represent fractions, one of the first things they try to draw is a circle graph, and even for a simple fraction like 3/5, it's very difficult to draw it by hand where it's very accurate at all. What do you have to do? You have to locate a center, then draw a true circle. So you need something that can draw a true circle with that center, like a compass. Then you need to figure out what these central angles will be. Okay? So to do that, let's see if we can figure out something. Let's label some things over here. So there's our party. This is our frequency in terms of number of years in office. Okay. And we can have a relative frequency. Okay. Which is, now let me do this. Let me wrap that text like that. And how about we do a little formatting here, like bold and center it both ways. And okay, so what would relative frequency be? Well, to get that, we need a total. Sum. So there's 224. And what we want to do is we want to take each of these and divide it by that one. But I always want to make sure I'm referring back to that same exact cell. I'm going to take the E2 and divide it by that. And let's change that to percentage form. And let's copy and paste that. And of course, if this is done right, those should add up to be, what, 100%. You can also have a cumulative frequency. Okay, which the first one's just going to be the 88. Cumulative frequency actually in this particular context doesn't make any sense. So I'll go ahead and show you how to figure it out, but it would make sense in terms of a Pareto diagram. So we'll go ahead and do it. So we do that, and it says equals this amount plus this one. And then we can copy and paste that because it'll always take the one above plus the one to the left. And of course it should end with the total 224, same as what we had before. And of course we can take these, I believe, and copy those. And I think I've got it set up so that that will give you a cumulative relative frequency. So if we were to graph these, that would be an ogive, either the cumulative frequencies or cumulative relative frequencies. Let's show you how to do that. So here is a, not sure if I can get it to add that to the Pareto graph or not. I think there's a way to do that, but it's a little difficult. So let's go here and just do this. That's going to be a line graph like this, and there we go. It starts at the first one and goes up. Sometimes I like to start ogives at zero and end up at 100%. But again, I should go ahead and add. Now the order here is completely determined by which one is the biggest, and you can do that because there is no inherent order in the data to begin with. This is not ordinal data; it's only nominal data. Names or categories, attributes only. But I can still need to get the same way as before. Pull the parties in for the axis. Like that. And you can see that we're there. if I did the same thing, well, I will. I'll do it. If I do it for these here, and in fact, I can, if I want a 0 in there, I can always add just a 0% here. Okay, just to add it in. And I can make an ogive that will start at 0% and end at 100%. With the blank there at the beginning. And so that we get our cumulative frequency going across there. These should of course have titles and so forth too, but I'm going to skip ahead because this video is getting pretty long as it is. So there it gives you some ideas of some things that we can do with Excel. You kind of watch me do that, so it gives you some ideas of some of the descriptive statistics that Excel will do fairly easy. Excel is really good at working with formulas and things in charts. There are also statistical programs like SPSS, Minitab, SAS, and others that allow you to manipulate some data. And the good ones, like the ones, some of the ones I mentioned there, are actually much more powerful than Excel in doing statistical analysis and actually easier to work with. Excel, on the other hand, is a better as a spreadsheet in terms of writing your formulas and manipulating them. Some of these programs like SPSS and Minitab do have some spreadsheet capabilities, but they're not really good spreadsheets. They're really good statistics programs. Excel is not really a really great statistics program, but it's a real good spreadsheet. But it does have some statistical capabilities, and we've seen some of those here. And I think this gives you a nice little introduction, little review of some statistics type properties, but it also gives you a little bit of introduction to some Excel. Hope you found that useful.